You might have heard about secret societies and mystery schools and wonder what they are. Well, they're all around us with various names throughout the ages, like the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, the Ordo Templi Orientis, OTO, the Orphic Circle, and on. Is the Watchtower a secret society? They have addressed this in their literature, and of course, they say they do not qualify as a secret society, that their tenets are public knowledge and anyone can learn and study to become a Jehovah's Witness. It's not an exclusive society, only for certain people or people from a certain economic status. But this is true in part. You might find this interesting about the origins of the Russellites, meaning the belief system founded by Charles T. Russell, who also called the International Bible Students that would later become the Jehovah's Witnesses. I'm not sure you'll find this information in the JW publication called The Proclaimer's Book, where it has a brief and heavily edited version of the history of the Russellites and the Jehovah's Witnesses. This quote is from page 539 of the book Occult Theocracy by Lady Queensborough Edith Starr Miller. Quote, "The Russellites, or the International Bible Students, founded 1879. The International Bible Student Movement was founded by Charles Taze Russell, 1852 to 1916, with the object chiefly of attracting the lower middle class intelligentsia of Christian communities, such as certain clerical workers, teachers, servants, and persons not accessible to direct forms of propaganda. In America, the movement has had great influence among the Negro element. In 1879, Russell founded the Watchtower, of which he was the sole editor. The Russellite teaching, drawing its own arbitrary conclusions and proclaiming them as final, professes to prove from biblical sources that all Christian churches are evil and corrupt, that the time of the Gentiles ended in 1914, and that the Jews must henceforth reign supreme over the world. It also elaborates an occult dogma alleged to be based on biblical precedents. It condemns a Roman Catholic Church, referring to Rome in true esoteric Masonic style as Babylon, and disposes of the Pope and his entire hierarchy as agents of the Antichrist, who are doomed to extinction according to the familiar Masonic formulas of Albert Pike, Mazzini, and company. We are further told on biblical authority, interpreting the following words in Revelation 11:24 as they speak, that this means that Satan is a name applicable to Rome as describing its characteristics. The Protestant, Episcopal, and other Christian churches, which in Russell's graphic language are the harlot daughters of the Romish Church and have committed fornication, which term he interprets as meaning the union of church and state, so bitterly opposed by the Jews in all countries, fare no better at the pen of this prolific writer, who predicts that, under the visible rulership of the ancient worthies, the Jewish Sanhedrin, those Gentiles who still believe in Christ will acknowledge his reign as an invisible one, while submitting as Christians to all the hardships these Jewish lords might choose to put upon them. Brother Russell gives us little hope for the time of tribulation which is upon us. For on page 122 of the Finished Mystery, He wrecks any hopes he might still cherish with regard to benevolent brotherhoods in the following sentence. As the trouble increases, men will seek, but in vain, for protection in the great rocks and fortresses of society. Parentheses, Freemasonry, Odd Fellowship, and trades unions, guilds, trusts, and all societies, secular and ecclesiastical. Close parentheses. And in the mountains, which means governments of the earth. The publications of the International Bible Students Association are interesting samples of political propaganda and seem well calculated to suppress possible instincts of revolt among such members of the Christian community as might object to the role allotted to them under the Jewish superstate. The present head of this movement is John Rutherford. The International Bible Students, The Finished Mystery, page 43, published in 1918, was that source, and for the root of this movement, chapter Roman numeral, chapter 76, and that just refers to B'nai B'rith and that the origins of that society. Okay, end quote. So you could look those up if you wish. So, is the Watchtower a secret society? Well, short answer probably is yes. When they do their preaching work, whether in the field ministry from door to door, or when they preach at work or school, they're only looking for initiates that they can trick into dipping their toe into the spiritual water surrounding the Watchtower. Then a Bible study will be conducted where they tell you that you do have free will inside the organization. You can choose to celebrate a birthday or marry an unbeliever. It's all a conscience matter. Of course, they discourage the practices because they want to insert the devil character from the Bible into the mix. The person studying with the initiate will say that the devil will now attack them due to them accepting a Bible study. It will get worse as they start to attend meetings, go in the field ministry as an observer, even begin to make comments at meetings. They will tell the initiate that family and friends will turn against them. This proves they have the truth, the only true path to salvation via the Jehovah's Witnesses. Many things are kept secret at this point. Why? Because when you're only studying with a JW, you may not go through with the entire course and actually get baptized, so they restrict the information they give you. Let's say you start your study and decide to end it and you go on your way. Well, what if you're asked what the study was like? You'll say, oh, they're nice people, I have free choice, all they talk about not celebrating birthdays, but it's not really true. I have free will, but I just didn't want to get baptized. It's a way that the society will be spoken of in a good light. It's only after you are baptized, making a public declaration of your faith, and getting baptized in public at their conventions, only then are you led into the actual practices of a dedicated person. When the initiate goes through the public ritual called baptism at one of their gatherings, they will be required to recite words indicating their newfound devotion to a god named Jehovah. All this is in front of spectators, most of them already baptized into this society. Then you are submerged in a baptismal pool and emerge a Jehovah's Witness. You are now required to bear witness to the deity named Jehovah and must say his name several times a day to invoke that spirit. From there, you proceed through the secondary dedicant part of the society, meaning you're dedicated and on a path to actually practicing what you've learned. You will practice the strict rules of behavior. You need to be aware of your unbelieving mate, beware of unbelieving relatives and friends. Some even begin divorce proceedings. Some issue edicts to their friends and family that they are now JWs and will begin a new life course of dedicating their lives to the deity named Jehovah and will go into buildings bearing that deity's name. The adepts will reach a servant level, which is intentionally misleading, as the elders and ministerial servants will rule over the rank and file and may discipline them or sometimes kick them out of the society. This is when you realize you can't just leave the society. You realize you cannot accept whole blood transfusions in an attempt to save a life, even your own. Slowly you realize that there are actually two sets of rules, one for the socially and economically prominent, and those of the rank and file of average to low income. If you need financial help, you'll be told to beg at the table of Satan, who eagerly provides public assistance, housing, food, clothing, anything if you're facing homelessness or starvation. This will begin to cause a split inside your mind. You will see the wealthy brother driving up in his Mercedes. You see him prosper, yet you're poor and hungry. You must still give a percentage of your income to the society, and you must rely on Jehovah. The wealthy and poor are two classes of JWs. They will never meet. You begin to learn that you're only there to feed the upper ruling class of the society. You give them cash, free labor, your housing. If an out-of-town brother visits a congregation, you must serve the organization as a slave worker. You try and leave, seeing that this is an organization where only the poor die from lack of blood transfusions. You will never see the secret workings of the ruling class of the JWs. They don't sacrifice themselves or a loved one on the altar of Jehovah. They get all the medical treatment they need, but the lower classes are expendable. They must get new, fresh initiates, as in any pyramid scheme, to keep the money flowing upward towards Jehovah's holy mountain, which is on a pile of cash. That's the mountain. It's cash. That's why they devote hours to the recruiting service, otherwise a pyramid will crumble on its foundation. The new recruits will never be told that you'll be disfellowshipped if you marry an unbeliever. Again, what is your social and economic status in the congregation? This is a clue as to your rules and the rules of the rank and file worker bees. You will never be told that if you accept blood transfusions, you'll be disfellowshipped. Or if you pursue a college education, if you pursue a high-paying job, you find you're the slave class. You are the free labor for the organization. I have witnessed all these scenarios myself, being born and raised in this society. Disfellowshipping means you're cut off spiritually, emotionally, energetically, and financially from any other JW on the globe, including your spouse, children, relatives, and your JW brothers and sisters. You're expected to die in that state, whether by your own hand or due to Satan, due to Satan making you ill and insane, and you die alone. Only so-called secret societies demand an oath of allegiance with consequences if you dare tell of their secret rituals, of the inner workings and coded language. With many churches, you can stay or leave. No one hunts you down. No one demands money or labor from you. Many other organizations are the same way. You can freely come and go as you please without repercussions. Think about that the next time a witness comes knocking on your door and invites you to go to a virtual or in-person meeting at those Masonic halls they call kingdom halls. What kingdom is that? Of God or man? You might want to tread carefully when accepting an invitation to a secret society, because you will be doing their bidding for a very long time, maybe forever.
For more videos, don't forget to subscribe to this channel.